you all to the valedictory ceremony of SimHealth 2021, a national conference virtual on interdisciplinary approach to healthcare, which is also a part of the Symbiosis Golden Jubilee Lecture Series as we at Symbiosis celebrate 50 years of excellence in education. A guest lecture on the topic Transforming Healthcare Services, Education, Teaching, Training, and Patient Care Through Technology. A hearty welcome to our chief guest for the evening, Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty, sir, Chairman of Narayan Hrudayalaya Limited, Bengaluru. Honorable Professor Dr. S.B. Muzumdar, sir, Founder and President Symbiosis and Chancellor, Symbiosis International University. Dr. Vidya Yerodekar, Madam, Principal Director, Symbiosis Society and Pro-Chancellor, Symbiosis International University. Dr. Rajini Gupte, Madam, Vice-Chancellor, Symbiosis International University. Dr. Rajiv Yerodekar, Sir, Dean, Faculty of Health Sciences, Symbiosis International University, the various dignitaries, delegates, students, and all members of the Symbiosis Society. For those of you who have been a part of SimHealth 2021, this ceremony marks the culmination of a two-day national conference that encompassed topics from various disciplines under the sun, from healthcare to nutrition to clinical research. With a 20-year legacy to carry forward, we at the Symbiosis School of Online and Distance Learning organized the first ever virtual SimHealth conference in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic that seems to have taken the world by more than just a storm. Let us take a minute to be thankful to all the healthcare professionals who have been working tirelessly ever since the beginning of the pandemic, and another minute to pray for the well-being of those who have suffered severe losses in terms of health, wealth, or loved ones. No dark cloud can forever prevent the sun from shining. We shall overcome this quandary too, together, even when 6 feet apart. On this note, I would like to request Dr. Rajiv Yerodekar, sir, the Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences, to give the opening remarks for the session.
Good afternoon, everyone. Chief guest for this function, my dear friend, Dr. Devi Shetty. Namaskar, and thank you for accepting our invitation. I shall refer to this in a minute from now. Honorable Chancellor, Sir, Dr. Muzumdar, Sir, Dr. Vidya Yerodekar, the Pro-Chancellor, Dr. Rajini Gupte, the Vice-Chancellor, and faculty members of the faculty of Symbiosis International University, beyond the Faculty of Health Sciences, and Dr. Devi, I would like to impress upon you that faculty and students from beyond healthcare, from the Faculty of Engineering, from the Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences, from the Faculty of Media and Communication, from the Faculty of Law, and other seven faculties have joined this session to hear your esteemed views, which talks about the impact of technology in healthcare and in a broader sense, impacting the life of the common man in day-to-day life. Today, we've got a double whammy in the sense that you are here as a part of a dual celebration. One is the valedictory of the SimHealth 21, which is an interdisciplinary seminar organized annually by the Symbiosis School of Open and Distance Learning, led by Dr. Abhay Saraf and his team. And you recollect that I've been chasing you. Generally, chasing you is an unparliamentary word used, but I have been chasing you for the last 7-8 years. And unfortunately, this comes in the first week of May, usually where you have got some other domestic commitments, which I shall not share on a public domain, which you had shared with me. So this is the first time that you agreed, and unfortunately last time, because of exigencies of duty, you could not attend the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. So we thought of best combining the valedictory of the SimHealth 21, the interdisciplinary approach to healthcare, plus the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series, which Symbiosis is hosting as a part of its Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. And Dr. Vidya would be talking more about the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. Suffice it enough to say at this juncture that we had one of your esteemed colleagues, Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, who addressed the students and the faculty at SIU a couple of months back on the very same day that she tested COVID positive. Such is the commitment of people like you, who are role models and icons for not only the young generation in India, but globally. So thank you very much. And thank you for allowing me to encash this credit card and the credit note, which has been eluding us for the last few years. I do believe that you are also looking forward to interact and pay your respects to our Honorable Chancellor, whom you always quote in our telecon. And Vidya has been a good friend, but we also have our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Gupte, whom I have impressed upon her as my colleague BOG at the Medical Council of India, what value of expertise and experience you brought to the table. We've been all admirers of your presentations, whether they are in print media or on talk shows, whether with Aamir Khan or without Aamir Khan, whether on YouTube. And one of the articles in the Times and the YouTube, which particularly impressed me and we've shared it internally, was "Beds Do Not Treat Patients." I really liked that article. It was tinged with a lot of humor and sarcasm and impressed or sought to impress upon the policymakers that we need human capital, human manpower to expand, irrespective of the resources allocation done by the government and the private sector as regards infrastructure and equipment and financial allocation. Your success model at the Cayman Islands for transforming medical education would be elaborated subsequently by Dr. Nabila. But I take this opportunity to thank you and would look forward to having your esteemed views on transforming healthcare through medical education, teaching, training, and also through the services. And before I close, I have a small photograph to share with you. And this is the group of our students of the MBA Hospital Healthcare Management, Sriram, Mefu, and Priyanka, along with Nabila, Nikhila, who've been with you, and they've got wonderful memories. And they all said, Akila Naik specifically mentions that despite your position in the organization, you always had time to hear the juniors, something which is really exemplary and worth emulating. So thank you, Devi Shetty, for being with us, and look forward to our continued symbiosis in all these domains. And Dr. Vijay Natarajan, who's going to be joining us subsequently for the Q&A, your colleague, professional colleague, because he's a cardiothoracic surgeon, will elaborate on it more when we look forward to you visiting the Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center, and particularly your Department of Love and Affection, the Cardiology Department. Thank you, Devi, for making it possible.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajiv, sir, for those really personal and touching words. Next, I would kindly request Dr. Vidya Yerurikar, Madam, Principal Director of Symbiosis Society and Pro-Chancellor, Symbiosis International University, to deliver the welcome address.
So the chief guest for the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series and our good friend, Dr. Devi Shetty, our Chancellor, Dr. S.B. Muzumdar, sir, our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rajini Gupte, Dr. Rajiv, my colleagues at the university and delegates and students who have joined in large numbers. I'm speaking here on behalf of the Symbiosis Society because Symbiosis is celebrating its Golden Jubilee. We all know that Dr. Muzumdar sir established Symbiosis as a very small not-for-profit organization 50 years ago. Little did we realize in the family that a small organization that was born in our home, Symbiosis, which means living together of two different organisms for mutual benefit, when he decided to start this organization for the welfare of foreign students who came to study in the city of Pune with the objective of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the world is one family. He believes that the Indian and foreign students should live together, learn together, play together, and promote international understanding and brotherhood. So with this thought, this small organization was established, and today it is a large multidisciplinary university of repute. We have branches almost in five different cities and three states, excluding Maharashtra. And recently, of course, the establishment of the Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center has added glory and a feather in our cap, which Rajiv and I are very, very proud of. The Golden Jubilee Lecture Series was one such attempt because when we decided to celebrate our Golden Jubilee, we were struck by this pandemic. And whenever there is a crisis, we look out for opportunities, and we felt that it's much better to have virtual celebrations than really have physical ones, because then the reach is far more. And people like Dr. Devi Shetty, who are busy, also get time to attend and speak to the audience, because as Rajiv very rightly said, that both Rajiv and me were chasing Dr. Devi Shetty to actually come physically to the Symbiosis campus. But we know that he's in the service, and such a great service that he's doing for people and patients, that he cannot find time to travel that far. And I'm so happy, sir, that you came in. For the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series, we've had excellent speakers ranging from Aamir Khan, Javed Akhtar, Minister Anurag Thakur, Minister Nitin Gadkari, Kailash Satyarthi, Mr. Vijay Gokhale, Saurav Ganguly, who's also your friend, Deviji, Chetan Bhagat, Shashi Tharoor, and you can just name all the stalwarts who've been there. And of course, Mr. Amitabh Bachchan, who's a professor emeritus at Symbiosis. But for all of us in the medical fraternity, Dr. Devi Shetty is the Amitabh Bachchan of the medical fraternity. The kind of work that you have done, sir, and the kind of legacy that you're going to leave back, I think the two legends, you know, one, of course, Mr. Bachchan in the industry, in the entertainment industry, and you in the healthcare industry. It means a lot for all of us who are not much younger than you, but for the new generation, which is very, very young, I think people like you are idols. And it's not just the skill of your cardiothoracic surgery that you are, of course, known for, but the exemplary work, community work that you have started, you know, is something that, you know, which will leave behind so much of legacy. And we, in our own way, at the Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center, which was the idea of our founder to establish a medical school exclusively for women, the Symbiosis Medical College for Women, and attached to it is the Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center, which is run totally free. And it is a 900-bedded hospital with, of course, one specialty wing, but the rest of the 650 beds are run totally free, whether it's a cardiothoracic surgery or even a small inguinal hernia surgery. So, you know, patients from, you know, all over Maharashtra and maybe outside of Maharashtra also come and take services of this hospital. So we are learning from you, Dr. Devi Shetty, for the enormous work that you've done, but your footprints are not there in Pune. And I hope that, you know, there is some kind of collaboration that we can have where you have your footprints in the city of Pune. And of course, in Symbiosis, which is an organization which is very, very close to you. So with these few words, I once again welcome you to the Symbiosis Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. And I'm sure there are several non-medico friends of mine and many, almost all the faculty members of Symbiosis International University who are more than eager to listen to you, because your writings on the editorial pages of newspapers are something that we really cherish. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vidya.
I would now like to invite the man with the vision, Padma Shri Padma Bhushan, Honorable Professor Dr. S.V. Muzumdar, sir, the founder and president of Symbiosis and Chancellor of Symbiosis International University, to address the gathering.
Namaste, Dr. Devi. Thank you so much for sparing your time.
Thank you.
To come over here for our celebration. I'm indeed grateful to Dr. Shetty for sparing his time and gracing the occasion. Dr. Vidya, who is the pro-chancellor of our university, Dr. Gupte, Gupte, who is vice-chancellor, Dr. Rajiv Urdekar, who is the dean of health sciences department, Dr. Sarap, who has been managing and organizing CIMHEALTH conference. Dr. Shetty, I am really, really personally happy to see you on the screen and to listen to you. I'll tell you the reason. I have been an avid follower of your articles published in Times of India. Whenever your article appears, I make it a point to read it. Sometimes I read it twice, and I have put some clippings of your article in my file. I have very high regard for you, and as Vidya said, that you are like Bachchan of medical sciences. Do you know, Vidya and others, that Quality Journal in America described Dr. Devi as Henry Ford of heart surgery? And because Dr. Devi performs pre-operation for poor people, especially in North India. In North India, people, especially poor people, call name Dr. Modi, sorry, Dr. Shetty, as Bypass Wala Baba. So I'm really happy that you have come over here for celebration. I will take some few minutes to tell you about the genesis of Symbiosis, which is very interesting and which is, it will be in a way similar to your organization.
Sure.
I was professor of botany in Ferguson College. And I was also a rector of one of the Jain's hostel blocks. During Diwali period, I noticed that one girl was passing something through the window of hostel's room. It happened once, twice, thrice, and I thought some affair was going on. And so I entered into the room of the boys' hostel, knocked the door, and Dr. Shetty, I saw a Mauritian student lying on the bed, suffering from jaundice. And when I asked him what was the matter, who was that girl which passes something through the window? He told me that, sir, she was my sister. She prepares food for me and passes the tiffin through the window. Why through the window? Because girls were not allowed to enter into the boys' hostel. Now, believe me, Dr. Shetty, that a Mauritian student put his head on my shoulder and started profusely weeping. And tears of that foreign student was a turning point in my life. Why? Because I found a purpose in my life. I thought that there are many foreign students coming from especially upper-class poor countries, studying in various institutions and colleges in Pune. And I found that those foreign students were neglected by Pune citizens and often discriminated because many of them were black students. So they had a number of problems at Pune. Problem of admissions in the colleges, accommodation in hostel, food, health, so many. But more than that, they had social problems because they thought that when we were in our country, we had heard about Mahatma Gandhi, we had heard about Gautam Buddha, and when we landed in Pune, our experience was different. Instead of having a cultural thrill, they used to get cultural shock. So those foreign students were really unhappy, and they felt that we are unwanted in Pune. So I thought that I must do something, and being a teacher myself, I thought that I must start some organization, and I called it Symbiosis because there was no dialogue between foreign students and Indian students. So those Indian students and foreign students may be different in nationalities, mother tongue, culture, cuisines, and what customs. If they come together, live together for mutual benefit, perhaps these foreign students would be our artificial ambassadors of goodwill. And that is how we started a small organization called Symbiosis. And believe me, Dr. Shetty, just that you found a purpose in your life when you started your hospital, I found a purpose in my life when I started Symbiosis. And in one of your interviews, you used beautiful word, power of purpose. I like that word. And I strongly believe, and Mahatma Gandhi used to say, that create a purpose and means will follow. And believe me, Dr. Shetty, I have experienced it. I found a purpose when I started Symbiosis for international students. Initially, Dr. Shetty, I used to bring foreign students and Indian students together on social, cultural occasions like Eid, Bhaubij, Diwali, Christmas. But I found it again, after the function, again there was segregation and there was no dialogue between foreign and Indian students. And that was the point, that was the moment when I thought to start some educational institution. And so, although Symbiosis was established in 1971, we started Law College in 77, Management Institute, and Arts and Commerce College, Competency, so many institutions. And it turned out to be a good policy. Because of educational institutions, foreign and Indian students started living together in hostel rooms, playing together in playgrounds, listening to the lectures together in classrooms, reading together in the library. So, the interaction between foreign and Indian students started taking place for a longer tenure. And I'm really happy that when in 2002, we got the deemed university status, we started opening our campuses. Our university got the wings to fly. Just as you have started your own centers of Narayan Hospital in many places, we started small centers in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Noida, Nashik, Nagpur, and so on. So my point is, this particular organization was not established basically as an educational institution. It was a cultural organization, and the culture was the first avatar of symbiosis. It transformed, or should I say, metamorphosed into an educational organization. So education was the second avatar of symbiosis. Another coincidence happened. I happened to see a very interesting movie called Anandi Gopal. He was to be knowing that Anandi Gopal Joshi was the first lady doctor of our country who was educated in America. She was born, brought up, and ultimately she died in Pune. So when I saw that movie, Anandi Gopal, I found it to be extremely inspiring movie. A small girl of 18, she had to face a number of problems in her life. Her son died when the son was hardly 10 or 12 years old, and she decides to become a doctor. And in spite of all odds, with the support of her husband, who was also erratic and eccentric, she went to America, got her MD, but unfortunately, when she arrived in India, she could not start practicing because of tuberculosis. She died in 1886. So, otherwise, I had no intention of starting a medical college because I had heard many bad things about Medical Council of India and the way they used to function, the way they used to conduct the inspection committees. You know, Dr. Rajiv told me that, Dada, you can start any institution except medical law. But when I saw that movie, Anandi Gopal, I believe me, Dr. Devi, I got so much inspired that I told Dr. Rajiv and Dr. Vidya that we must start college, yes, but only for girls, to empower women and to see that our country produces more and more lady doctors. With this intention, we started. In one of your interviews, Dr. Shetty, you mentioned one very interesting thing, and I'm going to remind you of that. You said that yours is not a corporate hospital, but yours is not also a charitable hospital. But you manage the whole, you manage the hospital in such a way that you do some part of charity, you also charge something from the patients, but yet that purpose of serving the community, serving the poor, has remained very, very noble purpose of your life. Similarly, we also have a teaching hospital. Now, teaching hospital is a free hospital, but I do not know how we are going to sustain this practice of keeping our hospital free of charge. But that is a separate issue. I will discuss it at a later time. But my point is, I found the purpose of my life in symbiosis, just as you found the purpose of your life in establishing Narayan Hospital. And believe me, I liked your statement. There is purpose is powerful, and that powerful purpose drives our life ahead. So without taking much of your time, I thank you once again for your time. We have been looking for this, your visit, for pretty long time. In fact, you were supposed to come before, but something happened and it didn't happen. So thank you once again, and God bless you.
Thank you, Mazumdar, sir. A legendary person of such stature requires no introduction, and yet I'll try to keep it as short as possible, and I just couldn't concise it anymore, sir. Let's begin. A cardiac surgeon of repute and a successful entrepreneur, Dr. Shetty is a highly respected luminary for his ingenious ideas for reforms in the healthcare sector. His visionary leadership to make quality healthcare affordable for all has drawn global recognition. After his post-graduation from Kristuba Medical College and having undergone higher training in cardiothoracic surgery at NHS UK, Dr. Shetty held positions at BM Birla Heart Research Center, Kolkata, and Manipal Heart Foundation, Bengaluru, before becoming the founder and chairman at the Narayana Hridayalaya Group of Hospitals. The group now has 32 hospitals with close to 7,000 beds. In association with the government of Karnataka, Dr. Shetty pioneered Yashasvini, a very inexpensive micro-health insurance scheme benefiting more than 3.4 million rural poor. A strong advocate of technology for efficient healthcare delivery, Dr. Shetty takes deep interest in creating and developing software products and applications to achieve time and cost efficiency while minimizing clinical errors in the healthcare delivery system. Dr. Shetty also has a US patent, system and method of facilitating delivery of patient care, a computer implemented method for facilitating delivery of patient care in adherence with the standard of care clinical protocol as described. Dr. Shetty is the current chairman, Board of Governors, Indian Institute of Management, Bengaluru. He has also served as member, Board of Governors of Medical Council of India and representative of President of India in the Board of Governors of the Indira Gandhi National Open University. Dr. Shetty is a recipient of several prestigious awards, including the Padma Bhushan, the Padma Shri, the Economist Innovation Award, Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year, to name just a few. He's also been awarded honorary doctorates from the University of Minnesota, University of Mysore, and IIT Madras. It is indeed a great honor that you have graced this monumental occasion with us, sir. Without much further ado, I'll hand over the baton to you.
Thank you so much, Chinnabila. I'm extremely grateful to Dr. Mazumdar for sparing so much of your precious time in discussing about things which is very, very close to my heart. Dr. Gupte, I'm extremely grateful. I'm honored by your presence. And my friend Vidya and Rajiv, I'm very sorry I skipped several of your functions. And it is my privilege to visit your hospital and perhaps do one heart operation in your new cardiac surgical unit. I'm looking forward to it. With all of you, hopefully with your permission, I would like to change the topic of today's discussion. I prepared very well for the topic Rajiv has allotted, but looking at the way the situation in India, the pandemic situation in India is going on, I thought I should express my views to all of you exactly what I presume is going to be the scenario and what needs to be done. First of all, we are born in a very privileged country. We have overcome several insurmountable problems in a very short period of time. We started COVID, our battle against COVID, with no PPEs and hardly 30,000 ventilators. In just 8 weeks, we were manufacturing surplus PPEs and ventilators, and we were in a position to export them in just 4 weeks. These are unthinkable by any standards. Now, the entire headline discussion on COVID is about oxygen. No one anticipated that it is going to happen in such a remarkably short period of time. It is happening in India mainly because we are a young nation with large number of youngsters interacting, working, and they get infected because, of course, due to the nature of the virus. I'm sure with the industries and the government intervention, in the next few weeks, we will be able to sort out the problem of oxygen because we have a lot of steel factories which is run by very benevolent people, very, very industrious, very, very industrious as well as benevolent people, who will do everything possible to ensure that every person in the country who needs oxygen will get the oxygen. I'm concerned, I'm sad, I'm apprehensive, but I'm not worried, because I know that the industries of this country will wake up to address this reality. But I'm having sleepless night for the next headline. From PPE and ventilator, we shifted to oxygen. And the next headline in the next few weeks, once the oxygen problem is solved, is going to be patients are dying in ICU because there are no nurses and doctors to take care of the patients. And this is going to happen. I have no doubt about it. Now, I'll explain to you why this is going to happen. We are testing about 3.5 lakh people as positive for COVID. For every patient who's tested positive, there are minimum of 5 to 10 people who are positive, but they are not tested. That means we are talking about at least over 15 to 20 lakh people who are getting infected every day in our large country. Statistically, 5% of the COVID positive patients need ICU bed, irrespective of their age. That means we need to have at least 80,000 ICU beds daily, new ICU beds daily. And many of you may not know, India has only 75,000 to 90,000 ICU beds, and all of them are packed already, and COVID has not reached the peak yet. And when a COVID patient enters the ICU, they spend minimum 10 days. So you can just imagine what the scenario is. Now, what we need to do? We need to create at least 5 lakh additional ICU beds in the next few weeks. Unfortunately, beds do not treat patients. We need nurses, doctors, and paramedics in that order. I must admit, the real workers in managing COVID patients successfully in ICU are not the doctors, they are the nurses. And the outcome of patient in a COVID ICU depends predominantly on the nurses, the way they have managed the patient. I'm not sure whether you're aware, before the COVID started, government hospitals across the country had a shortage of 78% of medical specialists. That is a shortage, existing shortage. So essentially, COVID patients are not taken care by most government hospitals. There are exceptions, but most government hospitals do not take care of COVID patients simply because they do not have the nurses and the doctor. They have the infrastructure, but they do not have the doctors and nurses to take care. Now, we need to produce at least 2 lakh nurses and at least 1.5 lakh doctors in the next few weeks who are dedicated to manage COVID for the next 1 year, because current pandemic is likely to last for about 4 to 5 months. And then we should be prepared for the third wave. I am just comparing what happened in England and what happened in US. Based on that, I am just assuming that this is going to be the way virus will behave. So far, virus has not differentiated between Americans and Indians. Irrespective of how much we want to say that we are genetically immune and we have the BCG has given us the immunity, for the virus, it hasn't behaved any greatly different with us. Now, how do we produce 2 lakh nurses and 1.5 lakh doctors to manage COVID ICUs for the next 1 year? If there is one country which can produce that workforce in few weeks, is India. No other country in the world can do this miracle. How it is possible? We have about 220,000 nurses working, who have finished their 3-year GNM or 4-year of BSc in various nursing schools and colleges across the country, who are preparing in the library for their exam, which should happen in the next few weeks. If the Ministry of Health, along with Indian Nursing Council, take the approach of drafting for the armed forces when there is an impending war with the enemy country, we should approach this with the same idea. This is not a peacetime, it is a wartime. If we decide, then these girls should be told, all right, you have finished your training. You haven't finished the formality of exam. You're all graduates, you'll be given a certificate. But you're given a certificate at the end of 1 year if you work in a COVID ICU for 1 year. And then apart from that, if there is a government job coming up, all the girls and boys, nurses who have worked in this COVID ICU for 1 year should be given a preference over the rest. If that is done, I am convinced most of these girls and boys will join the stream of a fight against COVID. And COVID battle cannot be won by doctors of my age. No war can be fought by people of my age. You need young people. Most of them are vaccinated and they are naturally in a better position to fight the COVID in case they get infected. So we can solve the problem of nursing shortage, which is a major problem. Now, what about the doctors? There are 1,30,000 young doctors today working not in the COVID ICU. They're sitting in the library, mugging the multiple choice questions to crack the NEET exam to get one of those elusive PG seats. The National Medical Commission should, along with the National Board of Examination, should conduct online test for NEET right away without any delay and declare the results in few days. And there are only about 35,000 PG seats available. And allot the seats. After the allotment, there will be still 1 lakh doctors, young doctors, who are left out, who didn't get the PG seat. They should be offered a huge grace mark during the next year of PG selection if they work in the COVID ICU for 1 year. And government should have a separate department of controlling this huge workforce and allot them based on the requirement. If you go to, we are only looking at Delhi and Bangalore and Pune. What about the tier 2, tier 3 cities? If you believe me, the number of COVID right now, it is very less in those places. They are going to be in the same fate as us. It's a matter of time. COVID doesn't spare anybody. So if the only hope for a tier 2 cities, tier 3 cities, there are no big private hospital to manage COVID. Only big hospitals are the government hospitals. And they don't have enough nurses, don't have doctors. These doctors and nurses can really make the tier 2 government hospital very vibrant for managing COVID patients. Apart from this, we have about 25,000 doctors who are finished their postgraduate training and they haven't yet appeared for the exam, and they are not working in the COVID ICU because they may have to appear for the exam anytime. This batch of medical specialists should be told that they can skip the exam and get the degree provided they work in the COVID ICU for 1 year. And apart from them, there are over 90,000, 1 lakh doctors who graduated from overseas universities. And they haven't been able to pass the national entrance exam. Identify 20,000 of the brightest of the kids and ask them to work in COVID ICU for 1 year for permanent registration. And if we are able to do this successfully in the next few weeks, believe me, we would have conquered the COVID battle. Otherwise, the consequences can be very, very, very serious. Mainly because just admitting a patient in a COVID ICU and giving him some oxygen is not going to save their life. When the oxygen drops, they need proning. And somebody has to monitor their blood gases. All these are done by nurses and junior doctors. This is May. We are entering May. You know how hot it is. Wearing a the PPE, working in the COVID ICU, even the fittest people cannot work there for more than 4 to 5 hours. And we need to look after those patients for 24 hours. You look at the number of people who we need. The current doctors and nurses who are taking care of COVID across the country have done a fantastic job during the first wave. They are tired, they are fed up, they are burnt out. And a good number of them are getting infected. Unless we create a parallel workforce of COVID, believe me, there can be a problem. Knowing the amazing power our government has, especially under the leadership of our Honorable Prime Minister, I have no doubt that they will do something dramatic. And we need to do something dramatic. In the end, all my speculation about the number of COVID patients and how many ICU beds we need may be wrong. But what if I'm right? It is too late. That's all I have to say. And I thought it is a fantastic forum for me to express my views with the idea that some of you may agree, some of you may not, but at least some thought. We cannot just watch the drama going on. We have to do something active. That's all I have to say. And I'm extremely grateful to all of you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Indeed, it was a really important topic that needed to be discussed. And thank you so much for expressing your viewpoints and giving us the ground realities behind what is yet to come. With this, we will be heading towards the question and answer session. I'd like to hand over to our Dean of the Medical College, Dr. Vijay Sagar, sir, and the Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences, Dr. Rajiv Yerlikar, sir, to kindly facilitate this question and answer session.
Thank you, Nabila. So, Dr. Vijay Sagar is the Dean of the Symbiosis Medical College for Women and my co-host for having this question and answer session. If Dr. Devi Shetty, you permit, we could get along with the question Q&A, which have been asked by students from across disciplines of the faculty at Symbiosis International University. So I do understand, Dr. Vijay Sagar, are you online?
Yes, sir, very much so.
Oh, great. So we'll have the questions being asked. So.
Ms. Mansa, student of public health.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon. I am Manisa Wilpi. I am pursuing Master's in Public Health from Kinross Institute of Health Sciences, Pune. So my question for you is, what do you think is the role of private sector in providing quality healthcare services at affordable prices, especially in rural parts of India? Your views on this, sir?
Manasa, I have very strong opinion about, first thing is there is no difference between private and the public. The future of healthcare today, till now, all the innovations are about better care, better form of treatment, innovations in coming up with magic pills, faster scanner, new operation. Everything was around giving better care to the patient. The challenge which you will face when you graduate and enter the real world is going to be how you're going to create a financial intermediary for people to access healthcare, what is already available. So the greatest challenge is not about building another hospital or a hospital group. It is going to be creating a very, very smart financial intermediary. In no part of the world, developed part of the world, people pay from their pocket for the healthcare. Because most of them can't afford. They're all paid by a third party, a financial intermediary. So we need to really look at creating those financial intermediaries. And the financial intermediary and the patient and the doctor shouldn't have any conflict of interest. Today, I have a conflict of interest in running the hospital. For me, if you fall sick, I make money. Right? So that helps my business. But the business philosophy of mine should be, I should take the money from you in the beginning of the year, and I should work very, very hard for 1 year, making sure that you don't fall sick. So if you don't fall sick, I make money. If you fall sick, I lose money. Then we have equal interest in this game. And this is the concept of managed care of Kaiser Permanente, which is one of the most successful, financially successful healthcare entity in the world. And that is what is required in India. And that is what you people should create when you go out of the college.
Thank you so much, sir.
The next question is by Mr. Jagdish Kishore, who is a student of our Symbiosis Center for Management and Human Resource Development. And human resource is something which you have amply stressed upon. So Kishore, you would love to have your question being answered by Devi.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm G. Jagdish Kishore, pursuing MBA in Business Analytics from Symbiosis Center of Management and Human Resource Development. My question to you is, the World Bank has predicted the need for over 80 million healthcare workers for the next 10 to 12 years. What are your insights about the future strategies for capacity building and manpower development across various cadres of the healthcare workers? Can you please share some insight on your UDAN initiative too?
Sure. Jagdish, there will be a massive, massive shortage of workforce in developed countries and developing countries. For your information, no country has the strategy to build the healthcare manpower now. Developed countries really do not have to bother about creating a strategy, because if they face a shortage, doors, and there are enough doctors from India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Africa willing to fly and occupy those slots. And in the process, country like India will be left high and dry. So a country like India, when we plan our manpower strategy for the future, we should not look at what is the requirement for India. we should look at what is the requirement of India and other developed parts of the world like United States. Do you know 25% of the doctors who are taking care of Americans are products of Indian medical education? 25% of American practicing doctors are from India. There are over 35,000 Indian doctors working for the NHS, right? Now, essentially, sitting here, if we say that a country like India requires X number of doctors, believe me, we will land in trouble because you cannot produce. Today, we are running short of oxygen. We have the option of importing oxygen from any country. In 2 weeks or 1 week, they can get the oxygen. But when you're running short of the intensivist and anesthetist, you cannot import them from China or some other country, right? It is not possible. And it takes 14 years to train someone to operate on the hand, leave alone the heart. So we need to prepare ourselves now. But the good thing for a country like India is that it is a phenomenal opportunity for a country which produces 24 million babies a year. The resources we have in this country are simply not sufficient to to take care of 24 million babies we are producing. All we can do is to give them the skill and tell them that the world is your marketplace. Go and conquer the world. And that is what we need to do. And our seniors, our ancestors have created the image, because Indian doctors are recognized across the world. Indian nurses are recognized across the world as true healers. There is a study done by Harvard Business School about the longevity of Americans taken care by American doctors and longevity of Americans taken care by expat doctors like Indian doctors. And it is proven that the Americans who are taken care by expat doctors like Indian doctors lived longer than the Americans who are taken care by American doctors. We are the natural healers. We have the brand as doctors. So essentially, we have a phenomenal opportunity. I'll give you one example before I finish my answer to your question. We have a hospital in Cayman Island. About 2 years ago, one of the nurses, she joined our hospital as a housekeeping staff. She was a bright girl. She enrolled for our GNM course in the hospital. While she was working, we paid the salaries. Then she became BSc nursing. She was a fantastic ICU nurse. And she, when our Cayman Island Hospital started, she was recruited as a nurse for the ICU because she was the best. And her starting salary at that point, I think, was about 1.5 lakh rupees, and she was only 26 years old. And she sent me a photograph of herself with the family in Niagara Falls. Tell me how many boys and girls from this country born in a poor family at the age of 24 can afford to take their family members on a holiday to Niagara Falls. It can only happen by working in a healthcare industry, because healthcare industry pays disproportionately higher than any other industry. So if we can be the producers of doctors, nurses, and paramedics and medical techs for the world, great opportunity for young people and a fantastic way of life and something meaningful. So it's a great opportunity that there is going to be a shortage. And it's a great opportunity for us to build the manpower for that shortage. But that can only happen if universities like Symbiosis tweak their curriculum so that they can crack the entrance exam to Canada or US or Europe. All we have to do is to look at what questions they ask to crack the entrance exam. That's all. And include it in your curriculum.
Devi, as I shared with you, besides the students in this audience, there are two not so young students who also would like to ask questions. And one of them is none other than the Pro Chancellor, Dr. Vidya, who posted a request in the chat box, can I ask a question? And the second gentleman, the second person is, okay, let Vidya finish your question and then I'll introduce the second person.
Yeah, so Dr. Devishetty, while what you're saying is absolutely right and we require more nurses and more paramedics, but unfortunately when we run a Symbiosis Nursing College and we also have a paramedical program called Program in Medical Technology, when we make the announcements, not many students are eager to join this profession, whereas you and I know that, of course, healthcare industry is much better paid than any other industry, and they can make much more money if they go abroad. So how do you attract talent to the healthcare system? You know, how do you attract, people to join the nursing program or the medical technology program? Because joining a medicine program is lucrative, but not easy with all the kind of NEET and all these entrance exams. It's far more difficult. But nursing and paramedics.
Yeah. Vidya, so I'll answer your question. Dr. Vidya is here. Rajini Gupta is here. She will know what exactly I am trying to explain. Nursing profession in India is a dying profession because they are paid extremely, extremely low compared to their contribution to the industry. Okay, I don't want to get into the detail, but the main reason is nursing in India has no career progression. When young people join a profession, they want a career. They want to see where will I be after 5 years, 10 years. A nurse who joined as a nurse, she will always remain as a nurse. Why? Because I'll give you a comparison. 67% of the surgeries done under anesthesia in the US. Anesthesia is not given by doctor anesthetist. It is given by a nurse anesthetist. After 3 years of training, after their BSc or whatever the training program in the US is, they would undergo the training and they are called nurse anesthetists. They can even anesthetize a heart patient for a bypass grafting. Whereas in India, a nurse who worked in the ICU for 20 years is legally not allowed to prescribe even a painkiller. Forget about anesthetizing. So unless we create a career progression for a nurse to become a nurse intensivist or a nurse anesthetist or a nurse dialysis head or whatever, right? So there is no career progression. And because they have no career progression, healthcare industry cannot pay them more. If a nurse can be trained and certified as a nurse intensivist with very clear guideline as what she can do, we'll be paying her 1.5 lakh rupees. Why not? Because nurses are the only people in the ICU who stand for 8 hours to 12 hours and take care of the patients. We have no problem. But legally, they're of no use for us. So this is the reality. And we kept it that way because it suits us, the doctors. So unless we change the structure of the nursing education and create a career progression, nursing profession will always remain as a dead profession.
Dr. Devi, another student who's on this forum is an internationally acclaimed psychiatrist, Dr. Rajesh Parikh from Mumbai. And he sent a request to be asking, in fact, he did conduct a very informative session just prior to your valedictory address on the mental health issues. And Dr. Rajesh Parikh, all yours to ask your question to another stalwart, Dr. Devi Shetty. Dr. Rajesh?
Devi Shetty, we're all your students. the simple elegance of your thought processes, along with your humility, will continue to inspire all of us, in addition to your accomplishments.
Thanks.
You talked about Jose Permanente example. I'm sure you're aware that, in China, even before the barefoot doctors, they had this lovely system in the villages where the local doctor would continue to be paid by all villagers until somebody fell ill. And the moment somebody fell ill, he had to spend the money to help them recover. So in a micro system, it worked. My question to you, Dr. Devi Shetty, addition to all the staggering numbers that you simplified and shared with us, beyond May, don't we have to prepare when the monsoons come for dengue, malaria, all the other infectious diseases that will proliferate as they do every year? And, you know, so many other illnesses, including cardiovascular and tuberculosis, have now been eclipsed by COVID-19, but they're not going away. So we need to factor those in also, wouldn't we, when we are talking of our doctors and nurses?
Yes, yes. See, the right now in Karnataka, we have taken a decision that 80% of the beds will be reserved for COVID patients. So we are canceling all the elective operations, only the emergency operations we are doing, right? You know, it's like a choice between the devil and the deep sea. So hopefully, you know, these things will pass off and then we can get back to our regular activity. But right now it is a great, great concern. We are seeing a lot more advanced cancers than what we saw in the past. We are seeing a lot more end-stage heart failure because at the right time, they didn't get the angiogram or angioplasty or surgery. This is how children are missing out on VST closure in the 6 months period. They are coming after 1 year, 2 years with severe pulmonary hypertension. So we are seeing the all the things what you are talking about, Rajesh. It is sad what we are going through. But do we have a choice? Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Aishwarya Kulkarni and I'm a student of MBIT from Symbiosis Institute of Computer Studies and Research. So my question to you is, today there is a need for raising a cadre of digital healthcare professionals. So what, in your opinion, would be the impact of digital healthcare on the healthcare delivery?
First of all, Aishwarya, contrary to popular perception, hospitals are not safe for the patients. Let's look at American hospitals. They are the safest, perhaps one of the, some of the safest hospitals on the planet. If 200 patients spend one night in American hospital, one in 200 dies due to medical error. Not medical negligence, medical error. Getting admitted to an American hospital is 10 times riskier than skydiving. So why medical error happens? Medical error happens because someone has done something without looking at all the consequences or the current perspective. Why this happens? Because all the data on which patients are managed are on a paper or in a digital format, which is not smart. So from the Indian context, if we remove the pen and paper from the hands of doctors, nurses, and medical technicians, and supplement it with a smart electronic medical record, my perception, my opinion is that the mortality morbidity in the hospital will come down by at least 25 to 30%, at least. And cost of healthcare will increase, will come down significantly, dramatically. So I have no doubt about it. The problem is the existing electronic medical records are created without really any respect for the end users, that is the doctors. Because the first thing, all the electronic medical records are created for the desktop. And doctors look at the desktop 5 to 6 times in a day, but they look at their mobile phone 200 times in a day. So if the electronic medical records are created for the mobile phone, patient will get a lot more attention. And the second problem is all the $1 billion electronic medical records has a keyboard. You have to enter the data. Unfortunately, doctors are not designed by God to type. So we have a serious problem. So, and also these expensive electronic medical records, say Epic and Cerner, they come with the instruction manual and you have to attend 76 hours of training to use the EMR. So if you give any product to doctors and give them an instruction manual, first thing they want to do is throw the instruction manual, because doctors cannot take anybody's instruction. So if you want to create anything for the doctors, it has to be intuitive. It cannot have a keyboard. So that is what is required. And if somebody can create that, believe me, a massive digital transformation of healthcare will happen. And if this is not done with doctors participating in the whole development process, you will never come up with a magic EMR.
Devi, just to add to you, to your thought process, one of your fellow Bangaloreans who was an aviation baron had once said that doctors are so reluctant and loath to use technology. If we adopted an IT system in the healthcare, we would be having a crash every minute.
Yes, you're right.
You know I'm referring to.
Yes.
So the next question is from Ms. Ankita Das. Ankita, can we have you? Thank you, Aishwarya. Ankita, can we have you online, please?
Thank you. Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. My name is Ankita Das and I'm currently residing in Pune and pursuing MBA in Hospital and Healthcare Management from Symbiosis Institute of Health Sciences. So, sir, my question to you is, while technology empowers us to change things for the better, it certainly will also automate certain repetitive jobs, replacing thousands of low-wage jobs. This will lead to unemployment and therefore economic disparity. Further, technology enhances digital proximity at the cost of emotional distancing. So do you really think that technology will transform healthcare positively?
I will, Ankita, I just want to give you one example. We started online healthcare with telemedicine recently. And there was a 78-year-old lady who I operated on her 20 years ago in Calcutta. And after I shifted to Bangalore, every year she used to come religiously to Bangalore to see me for 5 minutes. She was doing fine, but she felt that she should see the doctor who operated. And her entire year's life was revolving around making the plan, because she couldn't travel alone. She needed a son or a grandson to accompany her. And so it was a Herculean task as she was growing older. And around 6 months ago, I saw her online and she was sitting in her bedroom and she could talk to me. And the moment she saw my face and I started talking to her, she started crying, saying that I just couldn't believe, I can't believe myself that I'm seeing you sitting in my bedroom in Calcutta and you're talking to me. And my whole life's 1 year of thinking and planning was revolving around my opportunity to interact with you 5 minutes. And now I'm doing it sitting in my bedroom. So this is the uniqueness of what technology can do. I agree that technology will disrupt everything what we do. A lot of people are going to lose job and new jobs will be created. Because I strongly believe that in healthcare, the people who are actually touching the patient should be working in the hospital and all the others should be working from home. And that should happen and that will happen. Why do you need a reception in a hospital? Receptionist can stay at home and there will be kiosk in the hospital, because in typical Indian hospital, first patient speaks Tamil, second patient speaks Bengali, and the third one speaks Hindi. No receptionist is comfortable in communicating with all those people in different languages. So you have kiosk with the Hindi, Tamil, Malayalam, or a Bengali written. They go inside the kiosk, they see a nurse who works as a receptionist from her home, and she does all the procedures, and it is possible what experienced patient has. So believe me, a lot of things are going to change. If we say that in healthcare industry, there is only one customer, that is the patient, and the patient is first, everything else becomes minor detail. In the end, everyone will find a job or an alternative job based on their attitude. And I don't think millions of people are going to lose job in healthcare because of the technology. Millions of new jobs which are non-existent today will be created with all this digitization. So I'm not really worried about the loss of job.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So can we go ahead to the next question?
Thank you, sir. So my name is Sangeet Suresh, and I'm a fourth semester student of MBA in Hospital and Healthcare Management at the Symbiosis Institute of Health Sciences. And this is my question. We all talk about the negative impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, but what, according to you, the positive impact, if any, of this pandemic on the healthcare sector? Thank you.
There has been a tremendous positive impact of COVID-19. I saw about 56,000 heart patients in remote locations since 18 years with telemedicine. Every policymaker of the country was talking about telemedicine. Everyone in the country embraced telemedicine. But till COVID pandemic hit the country, telemedicine was illegal because it had no legal clearance by the medical council, and doctors are not supposed to prescribe anything online. And when COVID came, in less than 2 weeks, everything changed. Telemedicine became a legal entity, and doctors are allowed to see patients online and prescribe. This is the greatest change. The second greatest change is how the patients have embraced online healthcare. And my prediction is, irrespective of where the patient is living, they are going to access doctors at the slightest of cough or a body ache or a fever. They will see the doctors online in wherever they are, whether they are sitting in their house or in their car or the workplace. First consultation for any illness is going to be online. And those who dazzle them with a fantastic service and give them what I call as an Amazon experience is going to win them as the customer. This is the reality. And patients have multiple choices. Why should a diabetic patient is asked to see, can see only a diabetologist in their town? If there is a good diabetologist in other part of the country, they will consult. So this is the way healthcare will get transformed with the rapid embrace of technology by the COVID.
So the final question has to be the grand finale by my co-host, Dr. Vijay Sagar, and his student. All yours, Dr. Vijay Sagar and Sharika.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sharika Maris, and I'm a student of Symbiosis Medical College for Women. So you have expressed your views on reforms in medical education in India extensively. So my question to you is, given the prescriptive timetable recommended by the NMC, how does one implement and follow the provisions of National Education Policy 2020 for implementing multidisciplinary action?
Sarika, what you have asked me is very complicated for me to understand, but I just want to talk to you about the education in general in medicine and nursing. Okay? How it should be and how it is today. The medical education has become first an elitist affair. That will have a serious consequences, which I do not want to express. The second thing is it has become an academic affair. The real medical education is an apprenticeship. Now, what is the difference between apprenticeship and classroom teaching? If I go to a university, ask them to create a curriculum to train a bus driver, they will create a 500-page curriculum about how the bus's ignition system works, how the aerodynamic works, and every detail. But they'll never put him on a driver's seat and teach him how to drive the bus safely. Instead, if I send him to a driving school, they will never teach him how the ignition system or the aerodynamics of the bus works. But from day one, he is put on a driver's seat and he is taught how to drive the bus safely. And this is what is required in medical education, nursing education. This should happen bedside. And most of the teaching of medicine should be happening by your teacher who is taking care of the patient, you as the assistant. The first year, you should work like a nurse's assistant. And the second year, you start working as the doctor's assistant. And you spend all your time in the hospital, bedside, taking care of the patient. Not a visitor now, what you are. So our entire medical education should change. So I do not know the complexity of questions you ask. All I want to tell you is that the best medical education happens on the bedside, not in the classroom or in the library. I'll end my talk saying that the difference, I read about carcinoid syndrome when I was in first year MBBS, second year MBBS. They're all exam questions. Third year MBBS. Every exam I attended, there was a question on carcinoid syndrome. Then I did my MS, same problem. Then I appeared for FRCS exam many times. Everywhere there are questions on carcinoid syndrome. And in my entire life as a doctor, I saw one patient with carcinoid syndrome. That diagnosis also, I didn't make it. So essentially, we need to relook at what we are teaching the kids. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I'm extremely grateful to all of you for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Devi Prasad, sir, for taking this lovely session. Just a small little thing from my end. About a month ago, I happened to see your episode on the Surgeon's Cut on Netflix. And I remember talking to all 150 girls about it. And I remember Sharika being the first one to come to me. And she told me that, ma'am, it's brilliant. So she's been a fan of yours ever since. I'm pretty sure she's had a fangirl moment today. Thank you so much for removing such precious time and coming down and just addressing all of us on such important topics. I would now like to request Dr. Vijay Natarajan, sir, the Chief Executive Officer of Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I don't know if I have the honor of Dr. Devi Shetty's presence for my vote of thanks. On behalf of the Symbiosis International University, our Chancellor, sir, our Pro-Chancellor, Dr. Vidya, our Vice-Chancellor, Dr. Rajni Gupte, our Dean Faculty of Health Sciences, Dr. Rajiv, I'd like to thank Dr. Devi Shetty for having given his valuable time to us to attend this valedictory function. We missed our appointment with him a couple of weeks ago, and this time we all had our fingers crossed. Some of us our toes too, while we waited for his presence here today. I couldn't help notice the female influence on him in the fact that he first started practice in the land of Goddess Durga when he started off at B.M. Birla, and then the profound influence that Mother Teresa had on him, and of course, his name itself. As regards the opening remarks that our Chancellor, sir, made about, and Dr. Vidya as well, about him being a celebrity like Mr. Bachchan, I think Dr. Devi Shetty goes a step ahead because he's a Netflix celebrity as well himself. And I'm pretty sure Mr. Bachchan cannot do cardiac surgery. Another question I have for Dr. Devi Shetty is the secret to his ever-smiling persona. Someday I'll catch up with him at a national conference and I'll ask him that question personally. So it was wonderful to hear Dr. Devi Shetty speak on the success story of India's surge capacity in this COVID-19 pandemic, especially in the field of producing equipments. He also highlighted the potential disaster that is in waiting, explaining logically and scientifically the grim scenario ahead of us. He also provided excellent solutions to how we would be able to staff the 5 lakh ICU beds that we should potentially be creating. And his by now internationally famous statement, beds do not treat patients. In fact, Devi Shetty sir has another statement which goes, a solution is not a solution if it is not affordable. So sir, I'm looking forward to your book of quotations, and I'm sure you'll be working on that. I wholeheartedly agree with you. I sincerely also believe that it is the nurses who are the core of any hospital, and more so in the COVID pandemic. The miraculous solution that Dr. Devi Shetty had suggested in terms of how we could get our 220,000 nurses on board, as well as 130,000 doctors, creating the simile to this being a wartime scenario. Also, it is a wonderful suggestion that we give special provisions in admission for the nurses and doctors if they have done COVID duties. I really and sincerely hope that the government is listening to what Dr. Devi Shetty just told us. He also mentioned the importance of creating a parallel workforce in this environment, and therefore that desperate situations demand desperate measures. He also very patiently and brilliantly answered all the questions that the audience had put across to him. As he highlighted India's contribution to increasing Western life expectancy. So from one cardiac surgeon to another, sir, I'd like to thank you from the bottom of my ventricles. I'd also like to thank all the speakers who took part in the deliberations of the SimHealth, the entire organizing committee of SimHealth headed by Dr. Saraf, the IT team, Dr. Nabila, for being such a professional MC, the people who asked all the questions, Mansa, Jagdish, Dr. Parikh, Dr. Vidya, Madam herself, Aishwarya, Ankita, Sangeet, Suresh, and Sarika. And finally, sir, you wouldn't know a little thing about Pune. It's called the city with an attitude. And there is a popular fact that Puneites sleep between 1 and 4. So finally, on behalf of all the members of the audience and the city of Pune, I'd like to thank you for delaying the start of this session by 15 minutes. Thank you very much, sir, for your gracious presence. And thank you, everyone, for your attention.
Thank you, one and all, for being a part of this extremely noteworthy session. Please take good care of yourselves. Stay positive, test negative, and hope to see you all in person sometime really soon. Thank you and goodbye.